Almost half of the semester we were discussing force. We had discussed force. How do we measure force? Okay, the dynamometer, which is essentially a spring with a known spring constant. You exert the force on the one end and look how much it is displaced. This is one way of measuring. This is basically you are comparing an unknown force to a known force. So effectively, you say that you know the force exerted by a spring if it is elongated, stretched by some amount. Then there's another force, you exert another force, and it will stretch the spring, and by measuring how much the spring is stretched, you say that you know the force exerted by the unknown force. But how do you first measure the known force? So this just relies on the fact that you first measure one force so that you know that force, and you compare it with another unknown force. And when they are equal, you will know that they are equal. And then you say if they are equal, there is the known force which you know, there is the unknown force which you do not know. If they are equal, you know the unknown force. But how do you measure the first force in this case? Acceleration. We measure the acceleration of an object. You exert the force on an object. Well, that is how we see the forces. The forces are exerted on objects. There is no without exerting a force on an object, there is no point in talking about the force. The force is exerted on an object, and then it creates an acceleration. But acceleration, the mass times the acceleration, which is the force, we had just said that it is the change in the momentum of an object in a given time t. So by measuring the acceleration, we are basically measuring the change in the momentum p in a given time. And that change in the momentum p in a given time is what we define as the impulse. So effectively, when we are saying that we are measuring the force, some force, we are measuring the impulse transferred to that object. So the change in the momentum is, it's kind of if you just integrate this equation, the change in the momentum in a finite time is the integral of the force over the time, which we define as the impulse. And while our measurements are not instantaneous, they have an extent, so we don't really measure instantaneous accelerations. Well, the acceleration, how we measure the velocity at two different times and divide the difference in the velocities to the time that it takes. But the time difference that we are doing measurements are always finite. So this integral over here will be always finite, but we can always talk about the average force acting on an object. The average force is the impulse divided by the time the force is exerted. Now, if you have imagine you have an egg, a chicken's egg, and you drop it, it breaks. So how can you prevent that from breaking when it falls down? Okay, that is one answer. You just cook it, but cooking it doesn't prevent the shell from breaking. It will prevent the mess, that is true, but it will not prevent the egg from breaking. You have an egg. Elinizde bir tane yumurtanız var. When it drops on the floor, it breaks. So what should you do to prevent it from breaking when it falls on the floor? Okay, let me ask it this way. I have the egg. I know that when it falls on the ground, it will break. If I put my jacket on the ground and if I just drop the egg from the same point, will it break? Probably. Hopefully not. But it might break, but hopefully not. If you want to prevent it from breaking completely, you should put something even softer. the average force will be smaller. Since the average force, since you are, the idea, the impulse is the same. So initially, it has some potential energy which is transferred into the speed of the egg. So it will have a finite momentum just before the impact, and after the impact, it just stops. So the rate, the change in the momentum is the same. The impulse is the same. So the only thing you have control over is how long it takes for the egg to stop. So if it takes a longer time, like if you have a very soft pillow there, so it hits there, and it takes some time for the egg to compress the pillow until the end, but that means delta T is longer, so the average force will be much smaller, so the egg doesn't break. Might not break, let's say, if you are lucky. In the water? Into the water, sure. It will take a longer time for it to stop. The same idea holds for airbags. So that's basically what the airbags are doing. They just make sure that the impulse is delivered to you in a longer period of time, so that the average force exerted on you will be much smaller at a given instant. Other questions? And but when we are making measurements, we are effectively measuring the impulse. Now, this was one subject that we had covered, but we didn't go over it in detail. We had defined the center of mass, but we didn't discuss how we can calculate it. We had discussed the center of mass of a collection of point masses when we were discussing, okay, where was it? So here. So this we kind of discussed on Tuesday. So the center of mass we defined such that the total momentum of a system of particles, we have a system of particles. Now on Tuesday we show that this whole system, in terms of for translational motion at least, we can describe the whole system as a point mass located at the center of mass, moving with the velocity v center of mass. And the total mass of the system as a whole times the acceleration of the center of mass is equal to the external force only the external force. Of course, we can have some internal forces acting on the system, but they do not change the position of, they do not affect the position of the center of mass of the system. Only external forces modify the change the position of my system. And this center of mass we defined as the center of mass position, we defined as 1 over m times mass of the ith particle, the position of the ith particle. And also one point that you should pay attention to is, okay, so if you take this ball, if you just throw it up, the external force is only its weight. And the position, the change in the position of the center of mass will be only determined by its weight. I can just throw it with rotation. I can just spin the ball as I throw it, or I can throw it such that it will not spin. Whether it spins or not will have absolutely no effect on the displacement of the center of mass. Because the only thing that affects the displacement, how the center of mass moves, is the net external force acting on the system. If the rotation of this object, or this chalk, let's say, whether I rotate the chalk or just throw it without rotating, it will make the same motion. The center of mass will make the same motion as long as the relative motion of the parts making this chalk doesn't change the external force. If the external force is fixed, in these cases it's the weight fixed, independent of how my object moves, so the position of the acceleration of the center of mass will be this independent of how I throw it, whether it will be rotating or without rotation. So how do we calculate the center of mass of objects? It will not be always the geometric center of the objects. Well, the easiest example is just a single rod. If we have a single rod, we can calculate the center of mass. So we have this rod. Let's just put our coordinate axis, the x and the y axis. Let's just assume it has a total length L, and it has a total mass M. So the question is, where is the center of mass? Well, the center of mass we define for in this form using point objects. This mass I is a point object. And the Ri is the position of that point object. This is not a point object. So first, we have to write this as a sum of point objects. So that is what we do when we just divide it into very small segments. Each one is a point object. So if I just denote the position of the ith segment by xi, then Ri is nothing but xi in the xi direction. This is the position of the ith point mass. Well, if this is xi, this point is xi plus delta dx, the change in the x as I go from one segment to the other segment. Well, that is the, okay, this is the position of that segment is x, and the next segment is over here. Its position is at x plus dx. Dx is the increment in x as I go from one segment to the other one. So the mass of this mass will be nothing but the mass per the linear mass density, let's call this for the time being, times dx. If the mass is distributed uniformly, then this linear mass density is nothing but this mass divided by L. This is the mass per unit length. So if I have a length dx, then dm will be mass per unit length times the length of my segment. Then the position of the center of mass will be nothing but 1 over m times sum over all my segments, or sum over all possible values of xi, of rho dx times xi. And if when we take the limit that this set lines, the length of this line segment goes to 0, I have infinitely of them. The sum of infinite remaining zeros, if you like, is nothing but the integral. This is equal to 1 over m times the integral of rho, this is x, times dx, as x goes from, well, the initial segment has x is equal to 0. The final segment has x is equal to L from 0 up to L. And this will be if rho is just a constant, m over L, this is rho, times 1 over m times x squared over 2 integrated from 0 up to L. So this will be L over 2. This is the center of mass of just one line. Now you can have a more complicated object, the half disk. Now the trick will be exactly equal, exactly the same. So what you do is you just first divide this half disk into very small segments. Since we already have one result, we can also use this result, and we can just have this semi-disk. We have this semi-disk, we divide it into very small, very thin segments. We already know the center of mass of each one. If you take this one, the center of mass of this object is over here. You can calculate its mass. Well, I will not go to the details of this calculation. You have the length, since it's a circle, its equation is x squared plus y squared is equal to r squared. So this is L over 2. The other side is minus L over 2. L over 2 is just square root of r squared minus y squared. And the surface mass density is just the mass divided by the total area. This is pi r squared over 2. So So this is the mass density. So you know the mass of this object, rho L dy. You know the position of the center of mass of this line, this thin rod. So dm is rho times L dy is the area. Area times the mass per area is the mass. This is the position of the center of mass. It is at this point along the y-axis. And the position of the center of mass is just this sum, which you can convert to an integral. Well, this is how you evaluate the integral. You can just making change of variables. You can just go over them at home. And you can just calculate the position of the center of mass. Any questions on how to calculate the position of the center of mass? Now, just by after this 10 minutes discussion, I'm not expecting you to have just mastered how to write these formulas, the integrals, evaluate the integrals. But do you have any questions on the main idea here? The main idea is just you divide your whatever you have, whatever system you have, you divide it into very small parts. You know, you calculate the mass of each one of the parts. You calculate the center of mass of each one of the parts. And you just sum. You just form this sum, which just becomes an integral. And once you know the center of mass, just to study the translational motion of the object as a whole, we will study rotations next week, just the translational motion, it's enough to follow the position of the center of mass only. You can just ignore its rotational motion for the time being. Next week, we will see how the rotational motion affects the motion in general. Okay. Why? I didn't understand. I mean, you mean just saying that putting my origin over here, and then I have this side and the other side. Is this what you're asking? Well, you don't have need to do that. Because just taking the xi values here, they are negative. They will give you the same answer. You don't need to treat this part and this part separately. That is the nice thing about vectors again. You don't need to say that, assume that something is positive or negative. If it is negative, like the position here can be negative, so the vectors will automatically take that into account. You don't have to divide it into two. Now, another thing that you should pay attention to. That is the definition of the center of mass. Well, if you look at, well, this is the definition of the center of mass. So that is why I have this 1 over m, the total mass of my system. Over here, you mean? So if you consider the definition of the center of mass, well, let's just start from the momentum. You define the total momentum of the system as the sum of the momenta of the parts of your system. And you define the center of mass such that the total momentum of the system is equal to, well, the momentum is some mass times the velocity. The total momentum of the system, the relevant mass is the total mass of the system, and you multiply it with some velocity. So this is how you define the speed of the center of mass. And once you have this definition, then you can say that the speed of the center of mass is equal to 1 over m times mi vi. This is the 1 over m. So both sides are just the rate of change. This is the rate of change of the center of mass. This is the rate of change of, just replace this Vi by Ri. Okay, so this is the 1 over m over there. Well, there is one point though. Now, when we were defining the center of mass, this is equal to 1 over m, the sum over mi ri, where these mi's are point masses. But in this derivation, this ri should be point masses. But in this derivation, this is my very small mass, and it's not a point mass, it is a rod. So I'm just using the center of mass of this rod to represent this rod. Is it justified? That is one thing you should ask. So we define something for point masses, and then use that formula for objects that are not point masses. We can justify it. Let's just consider four masses. I have 1, 2, 3, 4. M1, M2, M3, M4. I have four masses. The center of mass of this system will be 1 over M times M1, R1, plus M2, R2, plus M3, R3, plus M4, R4. The M, large M, is just M1 plus M2 plus M3 plus M4. So these are four point masses. I can just write it as 1 over M, M1 R1 plus M2 R2 divided by M1 plus M2 multiplied by M1 plus M2. I didn't do anything. Plus M3, M3, plus M4, R4, divided by M3 plus M4, multiplied by M3 plus M4. The only thing I did was just group these first two terms and group the last two terms, divided the first two terms by their total mass, multiplied by their total mass, divide the second group of two by their total mass, multiplied by their total mass. So I didn't change anything. But if you look at this expression, this combination over here, this is the center of mass of 1, 2, multiplied by the mass of 1, 2. 1 over m. Let me just denote R12. This is the center of mass of the 1-2 system, multiplied by the mass of the 1-2 system, plus the center of mass of the 3-4 system, multiplied by the mass of the 3-4 system. So rather than just dealing with point masses, I can just divide my large system into smaller systems. Well, this just tells me that if I have a large system, I can divide it into smaller systems. And then the center of mass, I can just write over the sum of those smaller systems, where I use the mass of that smaller system and the center of mass of that smaller system. So here, in this expression over there, although I have first derived it for point masses only, this is also true if you take, if you divide your large system into smaller systems, and dm is the mass of your smaller system, and ri, since it's not a point mass, you cannot really talk about the position of that system in general, but you can still talk about the position of the center of mass of that small system. For example, that allows you to calculate the, let's say, the center of mass of, you take a thin rod, and then add another thin rod to it. So then we can calculate the center of mass of this system, because I can divide it into two. This is one system. This is another system. I know the center of mass of this system, so it is at the center. I know the center of mass of this system. It is at the center. So I can just say that, okay, this is equivalent to one mass over here and a second mass over here, point mass over here. And if I have two point masses, I can calculate the center of mass of the system of two point masses. So I don't have to go through these integrals all the time. If I just calculate some basic systems, I can just use their results. You can imagine, instead of taking just one disk like this, I can take one disk and then one triangle, or you can just devise any complicated shape you like. But it's enough that you calculate the center of mass of the disk and the center of mass of the triangle separately, and then just replace the disk and the triangle by point masses at their respective center of mass. So you have a system of two point masses, and then just calculate the center of mass of the system of two point masses. Any questions on the center of mass? I'm trying to avoid that integration part. You should first study on your own. If you don't understand the integration, you can come to me. I would like to skip those technical details. I mean, so I'm leaving those technical stuff to you to work on your own. And then if you cannot do them, come to me, go to your assistants, and we can discuss. Or you can discuss them in the recitation hours. Ask to your assistants. In the slides, I'm trying to be as detailed as possible. Just go over the slides also. Okay, this is another interesting problem that we can study using momentum conservation. You like playing with balloons? So if you just release it, it flies. You probably had the experience before, no? Don't tell me that you never played with balloons. Maybe not in front of like 80 people, but yes. Exactly. It is an application of momentum conservation. Initially, we have this balloon filled. It is filled with air. Air has a mass. So if I just hold the thing, the momentum, it has zero momentum in my reference frame. Well, when I let the air go, well, air has a mass. But it gets out of the balloon with some velocity. Since it has a velocity, it's carrying away momentum. It has its momentum. So you can just imagine this whole system as the air that gets out and the rest of the system. Well, the air that gets out has the momentum in this direction. Well, we have the momentum conservation, so the rest of the system should have a momentum in the other direction. That means it is moving in the opposite direction. Ah, that was not bad. Okay, so. Well, that is what we can study it using momentum conservation. We don't know the forces there. That is one of the problem. That's one of the nice things about the momentum conservation. In this system, we don't know the forces. So we can probably measure it, but it will be quite a complicated expression, the force. But even if we don't know the forces, irrelevant forces, we can calculate its speed using momentum conservation. Well, the idea is you can, at a given time t, so I just let the balloon go. It has some initial. It has some speed. So this is my balloon. it has some speed in this direction. Let's just assume that although the balloon is just making some weird motion with lots of curves, let's just assume that it is moving in one direction, just like a rocket, space rocket. So at some point, it has some speed in that direction. Well, the exhaust, this is the speed of the rocket, the exhaust gets out with a speed UE relative to the rocket. Not relative to my reference frame, but relative to the reference frame of the exhaust of the rocket itself. So at a given time t, the velocity is vr at the time t. The mass of my rocket at that time is, let's just say, m of t. So the initial momentum of my system is m of t times the velocity of the rocket at that time t. At a later time, at t plus dt, my rocket will have some different velocity. Let me just write it vr of t plus dt dv dvr. It would increase or decrease by some amount, we will see. dvr can be positive or negative. That's the change in the speed. The mass of my rocket will be, well, some of the mass is gone out through the exhaust, minus dm. dm is positive. That's how we define dm. Well, this is what remains of my rocket, but there is the exhaust that's going away. It has a mass, dm. And its speed is vr minus ue. Well, my rocket is moving in that direction. It sends the exhaust in the opposite direction. So the speed of the exhaust in my reference frame is vr minus ue. Note, I am putting the minus signs now. Since the exhaust is moving in the opposite direction as my rocket, I am putting the minus signs. Because I'm not dealing with vectors anymore. I'm just dealing with the components of my vectors along the one direction only. And this UE and VR, I'm just defining them to be positive numbers. Let us finish this example first, and then we can discuss your example. Okay, we know the initial momentum. Well, we have these two masses moving with those speeds. We know the final momentum. I have this much mass moving with speed v plus dv. And I have this much mass moving with speed vr minus ue. So I have, okay, this much mass moving with v plus dv, this much mass moving with v minus u, and this is the final momentum. You just multiply it. So we would have m times v plus m times dv minus v times dm. Well, this is a very small number. This is a very small number. The product of two very small numbers, it will be much, much smaller. So I ignore that. I have plus dm times v. Well, let me put the vrs. Dm times vr minus dm times the speed of the exhaust. Well, there are some cancellations. This will be canceled by this one. Well, this is the initial momentum of my system. So the change in the momentum of my system in this time dt, if I move this to the other side, the final momentum minus the initial momentum is equal to m dvr minus dm ue. Well, if there are external forces, you have to add those external forces to this system. If my system is under the influence of gravity, this should be, well, the change in the momentum in a given very small amount of time. It is nothing but the external force times dt. Now, if there is some gravity acting on my system, like the case of the balloon, then this you have to take into account this external force. Or it might be that these terms would be much larger than the weight of your object. Probably in the case of the balloon, in the initial time of its flight, these terms will probably be much larger than this one. So in that case also you can neglect this. If you don't neglect it, things get complicated. If you neglect it, things will be much easier. So you have the mass times the change in the velocity of the balloon. This is equal to the exhaust that you throw away times UE. Well, compare this with this term, there is a minus sign over here. Well, here if you look at this term, this term is, did I have a mistake there? Yes, I have a sign mistake over here. This is plus over there. So I have a sign difference between these two expressions. The thing is, okay. Now this dm, this is the mass of the exhaust that I throw out during this very small time dt. But that is, if I denote by the capital M, the change in the mass of my rocket in the same amount of time, my rocket is losing mass, so this is negative, but this I define to be positive. This is the mass of what leaves. So there's a minus sign over there. The mass that I throw away is equal to minus the change in the mass of my rocket, because the change in the mass of my rocket is negative. And hence, if you just put them over there, mass times the change in the velocity of my rocket is equal to minus UE times the times dm. This is what relates the change in the speed of the rocket and the change in the mass of your rocket. Well, the change in the mass of your rocket is something that you control. You control how much fuel the rocket burns in a given time, and hence goes out of the exhaust. This is what you design. So depending on how you design your rocket, you will determine this dm. And once you determine this dm, you know how fast your rocket will be able to go. Now you can solve this equation. Well, your favorite functions, the logarithms, appear. Well, this is the equation we have. This m is the mass of the rocket. So you can write this equation as dv of, well, let me just do it on the blackboard also. So you just collect the unknowns, the same unknowns to each side. M is one of our unknowns. So the change in the mass of my rocket divided by the mass of my rocket is equal to minus dvr divided by ue. Now at least in this form we know that the dimensions are also correct. Here is mass divided by mass, this is dimensionless. Speed divided by speed, this is dimensionless. So at least we don't seem to be doing any mistakes. Now you just sum all these differences from the initial time to the final time, which we call the integration. Initially, the rocket has some mass, let's call it m0. Finally, let's call it had a mass mt. And initially, the speed of your rocket was v0. It starts with some speed v0. And finally, you have the v of t. Well, this dm over m is your famous logarithm function. This is equal to minus v of t minus v of 0 divided by ue. So v of t will be equal to V0 minus UE logarithm of M of T divided by M0. Okay, M of T, the mass of your rocket at time T will be smaller than its initial mass. So this ratio is less than 1. Well, the logarithm is a nice function. That it's, if you plot the logarithm function, this is 1. The logarithm of 1 is 0, so it has such a shape. For any number less than 1, it is negative. For any number greater than 1, it is positive. So this is negative. This is less than 1. So the logarithm is negative. So the speed at the time t is a positive number. Okay, so this is kind of funny. Funny in the sense that when you are designing your rocket, you have control over two things. The speed with which the exhaust will be ejected and the amount of fuel you have. And imagining that at the end you will burn up all your fuel, so you control what the final mass of your rocket will be when the fuel runs out. So you know the final mass, you know the initial mass. Kind of the only thing you control is the exhaust speed. And one of the engineering problems is how you can increase this exhaust speed. So this is fixed, the final mass is fixed, the initial mass is fixed. If this is fixed, you know the final speed that your rocket will be able to reach. It does the type of rocket you use, the fuel you use, the type of rocket you have has practically no influence on the final speed that you can reach. The only thing your final speed depends on is your exhaust speed and the final mass of your rocket, what remains when you burn all your fuel. Well, the mass of your final mass when you run out of fuel is nothing but your initial mass minus the mass of the fuel. So it depends indirectly on the mass of the fuel, because the mass of the fuel, well, the final mass doesn't really change much. I mean, at least you should still be there in the rocket at the end. So your mass, the final mass, has a lower limit. But you can increase the initial mass by putting more fuel. This is hidden here. But if you burn the fuel fast or burn the fuel slowly, it doesn't have any effect. Assuming you can ignore gravity. We didn't take into account the effect of gravity. Gravity will modify this picture. So any questions before we give a break? No, it goes to infinity. It doesn't become horizontal. It's almost horizontal, linear, but it keeps on bending until infinity. It doesn't really become linear. Okay, I will have one question. Here. Well, that is the definition of this integral. The logarithm is the definition of this integral. That is why we have this weird function. And if you integrate 1 over x from 1 to, let's say, y, this is defined as the logarithm of y. It is the definition. Okay, before you go, on Tuesday I made this announcement about a survey we had. It was a request from the education department. Well, it's a survey in Turkish, so I will repeat the announcement in Turkish.